Hey everybody, we're just waiting now for Sava, for Mr. Posh. I had forgotten to send the link. It was sitting there unsent, so we'll wait a moment. And I'll touch on what we're going to go over today. For those of you who don't know, I'm Garrett Don. I'm the Radical Undoing guy. I help get people out of their heads, back into the bodies, and in so doing, some of the beautiful side effects are you can overcome anxiety. You can overcome existential dread. You can overcome stress and burnout, connect more deeply with yourself, with grounded present moment awareness, and lots of other cool side benefits. But the main thing is getting out of the hell of the imagination, getting out of overreactivity to feelings and emotions, getting in touch with what's actually going on and knowing the difference between what's actually going on around you and within you versus the contents of the imagination. From there, your life can be a whole lot, let's say, more peaceful, more connected, more aware, more grounded, let's say. You're able to face the struggles and the sufferings of life without running away or falling into fight or flight response or running off into endless intellectual and psychological seeking. And that touches on a little bit what we're going to cover today when Posh comes on. And we'll probably go about an hour or so. If you guys have questions, you can put them in the comments here. And also, just so you're aware, if you are into this, you want to get check out the work that I do, you can get a lot of free samples. You look around here on the YouTube channel. There's a bunch of stuff in the live stream tab, but there's also some playlists with some simple physical exercises you can do to break apart your chronic tensions in the face and in the body, which also then breaks apart over time, slowly, your chronic reactions to things, meaning your historic personality starts to lose its hold over you. So you can stop falling into repetitive patterns and reactions and start living life in present reality, where life is actually happening. So if you want to do that, you can check it out at radicalundoing.com. You can also sign up on our email list. You get all kinds of cool stuff with that, some exercises and some interesting paradigm shifts. And then if you want to check out the training or dive into that, you can check it out at summerland.acadal.com/pricing. That's down below in the description. And then also, if you want to go even deeper, I've got two pretty sweet and deep workshops I made like 13 years ago, I think, 12 years ago, let's say. One called The Manipulated Life, and then the next one called The Flowing Life. You can get both of those for free, plus a bunch of other cool bonuses, if you go to the link down in the description. That's the third link, the free workshops one. So check that out. And when you go to that, you'll also have the opportunity to invest in like a lot deeper material, a huge swath of courses that I made over the years dealing with social anxiety, 28-day intensive program, all kinds of cool radical undoing stuff. But the core of it, if we boil it all down, is just, like I said at the beginning, to get out of the hell of the mind, back into the grounded awareness of the body and what's actually going on. See, because most of the time people are lost in what I call the snow globe or the world of words, this hellish snow globe where every happening in the mind triggers some physical tension in the body, which leads to some habitual emotional reaction. And that's how you mess up your life. And when you live in a constant repetition of overreactivity for years or decades at a time, it all seems normal. And when the people that are in your life or your parents have lived that way as well, it's hard to know even or be aware that there's something outside of that way of being, that way of existing. So what Radical Undoing does is breaks into that chronic tension in the body, gets the breath moving naturally again. Nothing fancy, just breaking the chronic tension, get you back to natural breathing. And then from there, your body image, let's say, or the map of tensions in your body starts to maintain less and less and less chronic tension. So you can be alert, you can be energetic, but at the same time, relaxed. Now, that's something a lot of people have trouble with, relaxing. So this work will teach you how to do that. And then from there, especially if you're someone in my audience who's a habitual seeker, like I used to be, as I said in the description or in the email I sent out today, if you're a habitual seeker, you'll be able to go back and look at your collection of books, your collection of PDFs, and the people you listen to on YouTube and see how much of that is actually full of shit. You'll be able to tell what is actual grounded wisdom that you can put into practice, and then what is just fancy words spinning you out psychologically and intellectually. Now, most of the seeking milieu, personal development, self-help, and all this stuff is in that category of bullshit. But you need to be able to tell the difference for yourself in the body, okay? It's a little bit easier in things like martial arts or in rock climbing, but a little more difficult on what people call spirituality or all this seeking kind of stuff. Okay, it looks like Mr. Posh is here. So let's go ahead and add him. Here we go. Hey, what's up, Posh?
Well, I feel included now. I'm added. I'm no longer marginalized.
The marginalization lasted like 2 seconds. But
you can laugh because you don't know what it feels like.
Right. I didn't grow up. You grew up in somewhat, not from the inside, but from the outside, maybe in a marginalized country. So on the global stage.
Oh, yeah. A bit marginalized with all the bombing and stuff.
And you're somewhat in a marginalized part of the nation too, right? So compared to
sort of, yes. We had a lot of industry here, but when Yugoslavia broke up, supply lines were shattered, and yeah. There you go, lots of non-operative factories.
Yeah. So I was just bantering a little bit before you came on. And that was my fault. I didn't send the link straight away. I had it sitting there in the chat. I didn't press send. So,
oh yeah, that happens to me all the time.
So here we are. I know we had discussed. Let's see if I find the photo here, the screenshot. Yeah, we had discussed a few possible topics, but today I wanted to cover, as it says in the description, how to look beyond our shared brokenness when we're relating to other people. I have a couple stories related to that. Touching on the failures of personal development, psychology, psychiatry, I call that modern spirituality, generally. It's kind of become this quasi-spiritual or secular seeking.
Yes, so it's a rebout of modern thinking, the place where you can seek some type of shelter from materialism. Even though it's materialistic in nature, it's like a quasi-metaphysics. If not spiritual, at least it's somewhat metaphysical in practice.
Right. Well, and the interesting thing, I think the impulse is correct, of course. The impulse is a normal part of seeking the truth, a normal part of human experience to yearn for the truth. And I think it gets hijacked somewhere along the way. Mainly the ubiquity of endless amounts of spiritual stuff, so-called spiritual stuff. Like the poster child is like Jay Shetty, who just kind of copy and paste from whatever Hindu or Buddhist or what or other spiritual gurus takes it as his own, which is funny because he's promoting some kind of spirituality in his whole channel, his whole thing, and you guys can research this on your own, but it's built on plagiarism and theft. And then he's promoting some kind of value system.
Yeah, I mean, people love their latitudinal, room. That's part of modern spirituality, you know, this hatred of dogma. Mm-hmm. The word dogma itself in Greek was used to describe like the outlines of, you know, where you would keep your flock and stuff, you know, like these boundary markers, basically. So dogma isn't exactly necessarily like a mold. It's more of an outline, like you don't go beyond this.
Yeah.
Right. So that's why, but they hear it and they think rigorosity, and you need rigor if you're going to have anything, but they don't, they try to circumnavigate the idea of dogma by appealing to obviousness. You know, it is so apparent that you don't need to have it explained or something. Like, why do you get human rights? Why do you get human value? Why go for empathy instead of domination? Well, you know, they appeal to that, and that's a substitute for dogmatic thinking, to say it's just obvious.
Yeah.
I mentioned it because of Hinduism and Buddhism have lots of room to move around. In a general sense, I'm fairly certain that a lot of these sects can be very rigorous, but then you sort of, like with Protestantism, yeah, we no longer like this one, we're hopping over to the next one. So you're in the camp, but you don't have to submit to any authority, you don't have to experience any humility. And I think that's a massive attraction of New Age thinking, is that it's massive egocentrism under a thin but personally convincing veneer of outward, you know, empathy.
Yeah, there was this video going around for a while called, it was something like the egg, or what is our purpose, or something like this. And it was a beautifully made video, you know, with animation and emotional sounds and music and things. And so I could see the appeal in it. But the basic premise in the end was that each of us as an individual experiences every possible every possible life that it's possible, every life that is possible to live. Meaning, like, one life you're a National Socialist general, and then the next life you're in the camps, and in the next, you know, so whatever you are doing this life, it doesn't really matter because you're going to experience the opposite and everything else. And it's horrific, but it's not really horrific because it's all just you in the end. And presented with the music and everything, I could see why that's comforting to someone who's kind of wondering what the hell's going on here. And as you said, there's no humility in it. And of course, we need to account for why humility is good, and we can do so from the Orthodox worldview. But if you boil it down, it's just robotic then. It would mean that everything's pre-scripted, and that you're just being taken on like a Disney ride through horrors and joys and everything else. But it's ultimately just a 3D tactile hallucination or movie unfolding.
Sort of, yes, because you are experiencing it. I don't know how they're supposed to account for, again, free will. And is it a choice if you also have to endure the opposite, you know, meaning that whatever you answer, you're answering both, or a multiplicity of answers, you know, because would you, I don't know, stab this dog? And you say yes, as you should, but then you're also going to experience, but you're also going to go through the experience of saying no, so you haven't really made any choice.
And the experience of being the dog and everything else.
Oh, yes. I'm emphasizing the fact that you don't ever choose anything, because all choices are always being made in a sense.
Yeah. And then there's the other idea I saw on one of Jim Bob's streams yesterday or the day before. He was showing that kind of alien-looking bald guy with the unblinking over and over. He let it play. It was horrific, but it was like, and I've heard a lot of the New Agers talk about, like, oh, you need to access this, your prosperous timeline, or your, like, as if there's all these levels of experience. I can kind of understand what they're inverting, what they're distorting is, yes, you could be stuck in your head. You could fall into despair. And then, of course, the way you perceive your reality is going to be different, but there's no need for calling it an alternate timeline or like throwing in all these other worldviews like this. I think they're drawing on quantum physics and then completely distorting whatever might be there.
Yes, and also, like with psychology, there is truth in it. You know, you can't really work with a complete lie. There has to be some overlap, otherwise it just fails. You know, if you're good at lying, you're going to go with mostly truth, but then try to fit in as much lies as you can, distort it, change its trajectory. You don't go for just outright falsity. And the correctness in this type of thinking is, we as Christians are always told to be joyful, irrespective of what the circumstances that we're in, because ultimately the battle is won, basically. The resurrection has finished that. So we know we are still dealing with sort of the refuse of it. But there is no way to lose completely other than by falling away from God. But if you're a Christian, that's the only thing to really worry about. But joy is the overriding theme. There is place for feasting and fasting, of course. I'm not saying we shouldn't dwell on our failures or shortcomings, but it's also about not despairing. Great spiritual advice that I've heard is always, it's you don't need the demons to push you to sin, but they will push you to not repent of it, to not confess, to not deal with it. So, because you don't need a lot of help sinning, you need help repenting of it and changing your ways. So, what was my original point? The joy. So the mindset is important. Scrupulosity is a big problem for many Christians. We tend to associate scrupulosity more with Catholicism because of how it works and how, unfortunately, as it's been very succinctly put, they sort of shifted the focus from the Sunday, from the resurrection, to Good Friday. It's now all about the cross. It's about the cross and how much Christ suffered and the bleeding. And when you watch Passion of the Christ, it's almost gore. But that's not the crucial part of it. It is a crucial element of the whole salvific work of Christ, but the culmination, the apex, is his complete and utter victory over hell, over death, over sin. That's the reason to be joyful. But scrupulosity also happens in with Orthodox people, with Protestants. The easiest example is people who force themselves to throw up if they during Lent eat something that has possibly contains traces of milk, and then I failed, I should just die, I'm a miserable wretch, and then that's not a godly way of approaching things, but unfortunately when it becomes rules-based, or at least if you perceive it as rules-based, it opens a very dangerous gate.
Yeah. Well, I noticed I was talking earlier before you came on about just, again, this grounded present moment awareness, which seems like the basic foundation for any kind of struggle, any kind of conscious effort. And of course, you get lost and then remember again, but you inspired me today. I was... When I got some of your messages, you said you were at the gym, and I realized, man, I kind of gave up on working out. I think like maybe it's almost been a year. It's at least been 6-7 months. Now, okay, I bike around a lot. I'm not like invalid yet, but I see like I'm 46 and I start to see like, oh man, I can keep my at least a certain amount of strength and these gifts I've been given, like of health and good teeth or whatever basics. I can walk, but I realized I was neglecting it. And then when I saw, okay, Posh is working out, I was at a cafe bar. I had Americano, and then I almost got it with milk. And then I was like, no, okay, it's Wednesday. So that was a tiny struggle, okay? But that was, but in that moment, I could feel it. There was this push, like, just get it with milk. Who cares? You know, this voice. And I'm like, no, okay, Americano, fine. Have my coffee, no problem. Then let's say 3, 4, 5 minutes later, in my mind is beer's okay on fast days. And I was like, no, no. Please, no, I don't want to drink beer today. I'm gaining weight. I'd rather work out. So then I realized, okay, I got an hour left here, no beer. And I thought of the beer like, let's say, 10 times while I'm sitting there. It comes in, it goes away, it comes in, it goes away. I mean, it wasn't maybe it sounds like a minor struggle, but I think that's where the struggle is. At least I'm noticing that. That's where I can gain a tiny bit of ground, at least.
Well, those things add up. Okay, but... I have a bigger problem probably than you with struggling with alcohol, but like milk and coffee is I find to be an abomination. So I wouldn't have struggled with the milk at all. And that's, again, everyone has strong points, the weak points. But it's the struggle in it. You know, the gym, we don't live in a time where we're, when we live a very active life, in the sense of, at least in comparison to, you know, how our ancestors would have lived, it would have been early rise, work basically all day, not necessarily backbreaking work, but it would be work, and very often it would be rather backbreaking. And I think that sort of leads us into this atrophy of spirit, that we don't work a lot. And then if you're like me and you've got a garden and everything, you know, that helps. Yeah. But, you know, you've sort of have that feeling of, yeah, I can, but I don't have to. Mm-hmm. It's not necessary. So, you know, like the weather's been nicer in the last week or so. So I didn't stream a lot, but I did work a bit around the garden and around the house as well, because it's warm enough where you can like let plaster and stuff dry up. Uh-huh. So you can fix certain things. Whereas when it was colder, there's a high likelihood of it going below freezing and then messing things up. So, you know, that helps, but it's not a way of life.
Yeah,
you know, it's like saying, oh, what do you do? It's like being a plumber versus, you know, unclogging the toilet like every year or so. Right. It's not exactly a lifestyle. So the gym, I think, is a good substitute if you don't let it consume you.
Yeah.
And I don't have that problem, fortunately, at least not in great amounts. You know, I've never been too obsessed with how I look, including like how I dress and stuff. But I've seen, if you've been on the internet, like I have a problem almost recommending the gym to people, because I've seen it. And strangely enough, 10 years ago or so, women used to post things the way I see men post now. You know, they'll, completely shave their torsos and they're completely ripped, you know, and mm-hmm. cut, and then post it, and they're allegedly, you know, more conservative, and they say things like, well, I'm posting this to inspire young men because masculinity is under attack. And I just remember 10 years ago, women were posting this all the time, you know, what I like to call the near colonoscopy photographs, you know. I'm saying the idea is they put that camera so close to their bums, you know, just far enough so they didn't get sued for practicing a colonoscopy without a license. But it's like, oh, no, I'm posting this to inspire young women because women are put under so much pressure concerning their looks and stuff. And things have really spiraled out of control on the so-called red pill side. And we've seen even Andrew having to combat the red pill people as opposed to the Christ pill.
I like to call it the bread pill, but yeah.
The bread pill. That won't work because the bread tube and stuff is already about communists.
Okay. Well, I like bread pill just for the communion, you know.
Oh, you mean we should be the bread pill.
Yeah, we're the bread pill, yeah.
Bread and wine pill. Bread and red wine. We can work something out. Needs bread, finesse. So take the chalice pill. we're seeing all types of deviations, and as I like to ponder on things and just remembering how everyone is still saying, you know, like repeal the 19th in the US and that's going to solve problems. And then they put up all types of statistics on how the vote would have turned out if it was only men voting, if it was only white men voting and stuff. And I just think the biggest, the greatest possible example of how people don't know to think, Gesundheit. I can't remember how you pronounce it in America. Gesundheit?
Gesundheit, I think they say.
Gesundheit, okay. But what I was saying is when they just assume everything is the same, but you can just change this one parameter. As in, okay, they think things would have worked out if you didn't have the 19th. Like, the things would have worked out in the same way except for this other thing. Like, that's not how how history works, you know? Things would have been different. Like, the propaganda would have been geared just towards men. And the powers that be would get their way. Because people think that the powers that be are afraid of the red pill movement. No, if it gains prominence, they'll just subvert it. It's not that difficult to do. People are doing it on their own. They don't even need a nudge from some, you know, Anglo vampiric creature, which is still one of my favorite phrases that I've invented.
I like
the Attenboroughs and Richard Dawkins, like Anglo vampiric physiognomy.
Just to comment on something you said there. There was a group in I used to like when I was an anarchist. I still appreciate some of what they did. It was post-surrealist. So there was the surrealist school, particularly in Paris. And then after that was the post-surrealist became what they called situationists. And they were like worker anarchists, but not fully communist either. Maybe they were, but they succeeded in taking over, starting a
like anarcho-communists,
kind of like that, yeah, in France. And but they were, I'd say they were more on the artistic side than they were on the politics side, but they mixed with politics. And then they caused basically or fomented a student strike, and then it led to a general strike in France. And they held their what was called the Paris Commune for 2 months. That piece of history isn't so important, but one of the aspects of what they were talking about, there was a book called...
What time frame are we talking about?
1969, I believe. 1968 in May.
Okay, so yeah. Okay, that which was completely organic and just so happened to also happen everywhere around the world at the same time. You mentioned the Paris Commune, and I'm like, wasn't that the revolution? they also refer to it, I believe, in the 60s.
But one of the points that was fascinating to me, at least, was this in the book. There was two books that were centerpieces in the French thing. One was The Revolution of Everyday Life by Raoul Vanegem. And then there was The Society of the Spectacle by Guy Debord. And I read a couple different translations of that. And what was important to me in that particular book was that any resistance or any kind of he was talking about how surrealism became instantly co-opted. It just got absorbed by the system. So any kind of sense of it being radical or revolutionary just got absorbed and inverted. So then they were post-surrealists and they were anti-surrealists and all this kind of thing. But then how that would also become part of the spectacle, that anything you do gets absorbed into the spectacle. And that was probably one of the first cracks in my seeking truth in revolution and anarchism, was studying them and seeing like, oh, okay, one year there's people out protesting and they're breaking windows and protesting at the Gap for some kind of deforestation, whatever. Then the next year, the Gap had as their display, you know, what looked like broken windows. They just absorbed it really quickly. And then people, you know.
Yeah, which is a funny thing. One of the biggest points of elite theory, like Jay talks a lot about, what's his name, Carol Quigley, who was upset at the revolutionary Marxists, because he says the revolution is not going to be carried on by like these ruffians, you know, like that was attempted in the Soviet Union, to a somewhat lesser degree here in like former Yugoslavia. We were lucky that ours were just crooks, not particularly ideological.
And right, better than Ceausescu or something, I'd say.
Oh, yeah. Better than basically anywhere else, which it was bad, but not as bad. You know, no one thought, oh, no, you can't allow rock and roll. That's you know, capitalist, bourgeois, you know, leisure and stuff like that. It's like poison to the revolution and stuff. It's basically just, hey, listen, just obey the party and we'll be fine. but on the other hand, like Quigley said, like, you need capitalism to bring about the revolution. Even in classical Marxism, the idea is that you need capitalism to establish an industrial base. Likewise, it seems that, as that was shown to be rather false, because, you know, the Soviet Union established an industrial base. It was very bloody, but it worked. I mean, the Industrial Revolution was pretty bloody in the West as well. But, you know, it's easy to glance over it. But at the same time, it's too rigorous, socialism and Marxism in general. You can shift it a bit, but whatever flavor of Marxism you establish, you can't really move away from it, which is the problem of revolutions anywhere, even in the French one. You know, you have to stick with your guns, because the moment you shift a bit is the moment you get shafted, because you're betraying the ideas, right? And we can't be wrong. It's only a matter of implementation. But capitalism doesn't have that. Capitalism can absorb whatever you want. In a very conservative society, capitalism would work marvelously. The problem is that it's also a very parasitic form of building a society, because it can profit off of destroying the norms, you know, by introduction of pornography. If you want the perfect example, it's the transgender movement, you know, like the conferences where I still can't believe that was a public thing. You'd think that they would have the wherewithal to not publicly do it, you know, and you'd need some type of, you know, James O'Keefe without, you know, the homosexuality, you know, to expose them. No. They were just live streaming it. This woman presenting to a conference of doctors saying how phalloplasties are more than enough to make up, to just run the hospital. All the rest is just profit. So if you're wondering why even places like Sweden have...
And phalloplasty, what is that? Because I don't
know what that is. Making a fake penis.
Ah, okay. Uh-huh. Man, so that many people are doing that. You know, when I
No,
was a
it's
kid.
just that expensive.
Oh, okay. So they're just, yeah, that's
They're
crazy.
touting the profitability of their model. So it's very dark, but then you think of places like Sweden, which is, as far as this nonsense is concerned, one of the most tolerant countries there is. And Sweden, among other countries, European countries, just said, no, we will not be doing this on children, you know. And you think, wait, why are the gay Swedes stopping this, but the Chad Americans aren't? And it's because the profit motive is much, much, much smaller in places like, I mean, in Europe in general, because we've all got nationalized healthcare in some sense, whether it's like more of a French model or a Swiss model, not really the UK model where it's literally just nationalized, but nevertheless, capitalism can adapt, and it can adapt you to itself. But whatever you think you're throwing at it, whether you think you're going to be like, hey, stop all the corporations, it's the dropping bombs, but now they have like a rainbow flag on them. It does not care. It's how it used to be promoted in right-wing circles. When conservatives were being, American type conservatives were being accused of being racist and stuff because they support capitalism. And they said, well, capitalism only cares about one color, and that's green. To which I say, the problem with capitalism is that it only cares about one color, and it's green. It doesn't care about anything else. And it can, as you gave the example of, they just create these like fashy, not in the fascist sense, but fashion sense, fashionable, like the art display of like broken windows. They also put up your flag. They'll make a whole thing about it. They'll employ armies of middle management and lawyers to do it. They don't care. They can push any agenda they want, and you think you're going to defeat it by complaining about it. They'll just take your aesthetics, put it on, and you're done. If you have some type of grand Christian reawakening, they'll just slap Jesus onto the bombs,
Well, we saw that with the Super Bowl ad, not to go too deep into that. I didn't even watch it, but that it wasn't exactly pushing some kind of traditionalism or any kind of,
Was
repentance or
it the
anything like
feet
this.
washing one, like the recent one? I didn't get into it, but I saw the basic outlines of it.
And I always get some ads now on YouTube. Or like it's like Mark Wahlberg and the guy, some guy who played Jesus in maybe in that show,
Yes,
shows, I don't know.
I'm aware of him. I can't remember his name. So, who's Chris
Not the
Evans?
But it's
I
like
don't. I literally don't know who that is. It's just the name that popped up
it's
in
for
my head.
some app and it's like it's for some prayer app,
Halo.
Halo. Halo or Halo.
That's a big one. On Freedom Tunes, they basically. But yeah, I got the same ones. I mean, the advertisements.
I get some weird advertisements. Sometimes just like Croatian beauty products, and then other times it's this Halo app. Food delivery, the food delivery is mixed in.
One big one with that is when you mentioned beauty products. Remember how the feminists used to complain how the capitalist system constantly plays on women's insecurities? And they were. Like, if you watch old advertisements for it, they were sort of like, you should maybe use this. Would help in the whole looks department. It was a bit subtle, but it was playing on insecurities. Now it's playing on pride. Like, you're perfect the way you are. This is just like an extra spring in your step, and it's working even better. So capitalism, again, isn't this omniscient system. It is willing to adapt. And if it realizes there's more money to be made in, just constantly talking up women rather than, playing on the insecurities, they're going to do it. They don't care. Most advertisements are for, aimed at women, because women do most of the shopping, which is why you rarely see funny ones, or even creative ones. It's usually just the most bland, like friendly things like, oh, look at this bee, animated bee that's telling you to buy stuff. But at the same time, we see it adapt and consume whatever it feels it needs to for the purposes of both profiteering, but as we have seen too many times to call it a coincidence, they're willing to even sacrifice profits for certain agendas. And social media is one of the biggest examples of that. Most social media just drain money, hemorrhage it. But it's worth it's worth its weight in gold in other aspects, like gathering information and stuff like that. So, yeah.
Well, what people don't realize at those levels too, like, I swear, working at some office jobs, now this is many years ago, but I was working temp jobs, and I started to realize that these banks, that whoever I was a temporary worker for, actually did nothing in that position. They just would sit there and occupy space and maybe put some files from one place to another in the office. And like, there was whole floors of these high-rise skyscrapers in Minneapolis and probably other cities, full of people like this. And at that level of profit and at that level of dealing with money, they can actually get probably huge, huge tax breaks for doing a giant payroll for people that are doing jobs that don't need to be done. And there was no one there who even cared. They, they made the semblance of working, but there would always be a pizza party. It was kind of like the show The Office. I think that's closer to the truth than people who don't work in offices really understand.
Yeah, I always took it as, the same way Friends isn't exactly your average experience in living in near the downtown New York area. Yeah. You're just single, working some, average job, and you can afford an apartment. And
we had pretty nice apartments on there too.
That's how I took The Office, although I didn't watch either one. I tried watching the American one. I don't like Ricky Gervais, so I could never get into the British one. And if you've ever seen, I have to send this to you afterwards, Harry Enfield and Paul Whitehouse doing like a parody of Ricky Gervais. And they sort of just look at the camera. Yeah. Just making fun of the guy, like his mannerisms. Mm-hmm. I now that you've given me some context about the paper pushers, as they tend to be called, also in Germany for years now, they've had the what's called the Quotenfrau, like women who are hired just to fill a quota. Mm-hmm. Because it's demanded of the companies by law. Mm-hmm. And they're apparently so sexist that they're willing to pay women and pay a man to do the actual job rather than just hiring the women, which is, the most shocking thing you can, but again, ideologues don't care. They'll just shift a couple of parameters and then say, oh, well, I was right anyways. They just hate the idea of women being in that position, so they'd rather lose money. Well, that's not how companies tend to work, but you're just trying to avoid getting into trouble, and you fix nothing. And I can't imagine anything more demeaning than just being paid to fill a quota. But if you need the money, eh? At least you're not, you know, digging ditches and mining for, you know, rare minerals. So
that's an interesting point. I mean, yeah, there's an extreme there that would be completely undesirable, coal mine or something like this. But there is, I was thinking about the movie Office Space the other day. That's the one that's made by the guy who made Beavis and Butthead. And it's pretty good film. Again, it's similar to The Office. I think you'd like the film. I thought it was pretty hilarious. But it showed like white guys listening to hip hop and on their way to work in traffic. And then they see some black dude drive by and they're like, oh, turn it down. You know, this kind of, they want to be that, but they're going to the office job. And at one point there's a great scene with this crazy violent hip hop song going on. And they all have stolen the copy machine, which was always messing up. And they're just beating it in an alley or like in a field somewhere.
Oh, it's yeah.
But it's the copier, you know, not a person.
Yeah. That's hoodlum behavior right there.
But the whole thing, this is a big spoiler. The movie's been out for 10 or 20 years. The whole thing ends with they're trying to do some theft of all this money from the company. And somehow it fails, or it doesn't, nobody ends up getting in trouble, or one guy gets it pinned on him or something like this. But by the end of it, this guy just quits and then becomes a construction worker. And he's totally at peace now when he's doing this physical work. But he was just suffering and struggling with the office job. You know, it was absolute hell for him.
Yeah, I didn't think it's necessarily even the physical aspect of it. But Marx was partly right with the idea of alienation from work. If you're not making, I think we mentioned this in some previous chat, if you never make a chair, you just make, you know, screws for the legs or something, you never feel a sense of accomplishment. And that's devastating for the human spirit. You know, even when you work around the house, you know, there's a sense of, well, this didn't work or didn't work properly, and now we fixed it. And you can take pride in that. You can be happy about it. But if you don't tend to take pride in like washing the dishes, you know, it's sort of, well, I guess I have to. And I think a lot of people who work the types of jobs like you've described, like just this office job, it's just washing dishes. Now that I think of it, you know, there are dishwashers who are doing so professionally in restaurants and stuff. Right. But I mean, like washing dishes at home forever, basically, until you go into retirement or get promoted, maybe. So that's the way I view it. It's not exactly, you never feel a sense of accomplishment. So you start looking for alternative sources of meaning. We can tie this back into the topic at hand.
Yeah, no problem.
That's how people get into ideologies. That's how people get into all types of this just low budget, you know, corporate, basically, spirituality. One which usually just tends to stick to aesthetics and quotes, like, yeah, you know, inspiring motivational quotes. That's about it. They're never supposed to make sense. It's just this empty platitude that you plug into for a sense of as a substitute for profundity.
Well, and there's a false struggle that goes on, and that's what's kind of devastating to see. That so I see when people post about human design, which is just fancy, complicated astrology with a bunch of other stuff mixed in. But it's if the base is saying the planets control your life, then it's the same thing. And then instead of struggling, as we discussed earlier, against the passions or against our more base nature, the things that we know somehow in our conscience we don't want to be yielding to, but we find ourselves yielding to over and over. Instead of that simple struggle, now it becomes intellectualized, psychologized, and then complicated. It's overly complicated so that there's endless amount of books to read and things to study. Oh, don't worry, you're a, I forget the titles, thank God, but like you're a Virgo or you're a reactor or you're a whatever the terms they make up. You know, oh, I'm this, so I'm struggling against this part.
Yeah, it depends on the flavor. They some go with like you're describing the nervous system. You know, what's it called? Like the excitatory nerve, and then you've got like the reactory ones, and that's basically the because you don't want to constantly go with like Virgo and Pisces and whatever, because it gets worn out. Or God forbid for the middle class white people in America, you know, oh, we have appropriated this from some indigenous, you know, whatever. So you just rebrand, right? No more Blackwater, it's called a different thing now. So you see there's a massive parallel between how these things work and how a lot of companies work. You know, we are not New Agers, we are Neo Eoners, you know, whatever.
Right. Oh man.
So it's just important that you don't associate it with the name or the logo. That's it. It's pure PR. And you can get back into the whole, you know, uncanny business model that you had before.
You know, it's strange. To their credit, the occultists that I knew when I was involved with that, the Crowley people, and then there was the Golden Dawn people, and then there was the John Dee and Edward Kelly people who said Golden Dawn was just rehash, which it is, and then people studying all the way back. To their credit now, these folks were studying, they were rigorous, studying Greek and Latin and going back to the origins of, you know, I would say they were attempting to be honest truth seekers, even though they were missing the point. And a bunch of them did flip over and become Christians at some point in there, because the literature is completely dependent upon Christianity being true, at which point you're facing a massive contradiction if you're still trying to gain personal power through rituals. Where's the power coming from? You know what I mean?
And it's diminished returns, you know, as you said, you can just have an endless stream of books, but it turns out it's just a rephrasing of what the previous book said. So you never get anything out of it in that regard. And, you know, maybe this one has the answer and it says the same thing as the previous one. Maybe that's why I said diminishing returns, maybe a bit more insight, but ultimately you run out of, you know, the breadcrumbs. So you just need to go for something real. And there's also an analogy to make to the corporate world, where, or even society in general, there's a sense in which you can make very high-end products for, I don't know, like cooking, and they're going to be very high quality, you know, well sourced, well preserved, well packaged and stuff. And then, but you need to have a certain level of mastery in order to make something with them. Yeah. But then you can also just sell cake mix, you know, some minute, you know, mashed potatoes, instant mashed potatoes and stuff. So it becomes this mass-produced thing, and that's why you used to have these occultists who were very intelligent, highly educated, highly devoted people. You know, credit where it's due. There's no need to call to just insult people because you don't like them or where they were heading. But on the other hand, nowadays it's all instant mashed potatoes. You know.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, if you looked at the old, some of the old conjuring demon stuff, and it's derived from Solomon, let's say, or at least they say it is. These old books of rituals were like, you need to fast strictly for 9 days. You know where the position of the stars are. You build your own temple brick by brick. You forge your knife in a forge that you created yourself, you know. And then now the same system will be like, just make a string on the floor for the circle, you know what I mean? It's like Dude, you're messing with, and you're gonna command a demon now with that string on the floor.
Just imagining you get some like crappy demon.
Yeah.
just retarded, like, can't even like, speak properly.
He's just drooling there and dies, you know?
Yeah.
And you, the next day you wake up and you have like a piece of half-eaten candy or something as a reward, you know? Like it's
yeah. And there's some type of occultist, Ben Shapiro, who's like saying, "Well, people couldn't even afford to have any type of demon before. You need." Yeah. They're saying this type of mass production blandness is better than, you know, what used to happen before.
At least we had artists in the occultists, you know, they could make a hammer, they could, you know.
The problem we face a lot today, because you get it was very esoteric. That's why I could never buy into the whole, religion was created because people couldn't explain what lightning was. So they thought there was some type of entity behind it. But no, it's too complex. It's too, how should we say? There's too many details for it to be that simple. In fact, archaeology tends to point to the fact that you don't get settlements and then you get religion. You tend to get settlements around religious sites. Mm-hmm. The sites precede the settlement of the area, because wherever you have people where people would congregate or go for a pilgrimage, there's a stream of people who would be arriving, which is very much true today. You can build something of greater permanence than you know, just your nomadic, you know, temporary shelters. You can now build agriculture around that, because you can't keep moving around, because you need the place, you need the site. Yeah. This site is can then develop further and further, and people can specialize, you know, the whole division of labor stuff. And when you mentioned the part about, you know, how you should forge this for do that, and then you have the whole calendar, when you're allowed to do it, what type of weather, avoid doing anything if you have a certain omen, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I remember there's a story about a Serbian leader after, you know, the first leader after we regained independence from the Ottomans, who got very sick, so he resorted to superstition, and he needed 7 nude old women to knit some type of sweater for him in one night, and they are not it has to be a moonlit night, and it had to be done within that night, and no one had to say a word. Right, so you see all the elements of it, and as you said, nowadays it's just draw something, you know, it's very, very corporate nowadays.
And maybe the same could be said for modern Christianity as well, as contrasted with traditional or Orthodox Christianity. That I know for myself, even I still have to really like dig into what is practice, what is struggle, and get out of my head and actually engage it, you know, on a daily basis, moment by moment basis, to not let it become just an intellectual masturbation kind of thing, you know.
Because it's very easy to do that. It's very easy to slip into the mindset. If for Protestantism, I found it always found it ironic how every time they appeal to some type of that we are prideful, for example, oh, you believe you can contribute to your own salvation. You can't do anything. You know, it's all in God's hands. This type of I wouldn't even call it monergism. It's like a sin. It's Dionysianism, but like yours doesn't matter or something, right? It's not a sophisticated take that you have, but it's always something that tends to somehow benefit you or makes things easier for you. Mm-hmm. You know, it's faith alone, and I'm doing it because I'm so humble that I don't believe I can even contribute anything. It was all done by Jesus on the cross. And the practical consequence is I don't have to do anything. So always ends up being self-serving in a sense. Like, we're not saying we're saving ourselves. That's not how we perceive it. We're saying we struggle to do what was the purpose of man. That is how we are reconciled to God, by doing what he wanted us to do. When we say salvation is not through works, we mean that, because works will just mean, like we mentioned, like some type of ritualism, like the liturgy.
It's transactional then, on some level. Transactional, magical.
Magic is basically the basic difference between techne in general and, you know, magic, and how we would perceive, for example, liturgy is like, we don't believe that you're making certain moves, movements, circular ambulating the altar by the priests, you know, is somehow the motions themselves somehow tap into reality and open dimensions or whatever type. No, we have a regulated system of worship. We have also layers upon layers of symbolism for it. And we are trying to participate in what is already going on in heaven, right? It's not about the fact that, you know, where you get the people who say if you cough during like services, it's invalid, or you mispronounce a word or something. That's not how we perceive it at all. On the other hand, magic is all about being precise. Mm-hmm. It's all about making sure if you need to draw some symbol, you need to make it as perfect as possible. If you are doing some type of incantation, you need to pronounce it as perfectly as possible. It's trying to trap. The precision is there because you are somehow tapping into something beyond the material to compel a spirit to do your bidding. Right, that's it. It's not about you negotiate with it. You can force it into some type of transaction, but you're trying to compel the spirit. We don't believe we can compel God in any way, shape, or form. But if we say works, what we mean is I can't I'll go and take communion. I didn't prepare for it. I didn't do anything. I'll just walk over through the church. I'm not a big wine guy, but hey, a spoonful doesn't hurt, and stuff like that. Like, that is somehow going to be salvific for me. No, because it's, again, not technological. Works would be, I also like to say, works would be for Abraham if he took Isaac on his own, calculus or whatever, and said, hey, God, I'll sacrifice this kid for you. Or to you, rather. Like, that would be works. Faith, as in which, again, much more properly translated as faithfulness, is that he was doing the will of God. Right? Works, apart from faith, would be that type of thinking, that more magical, more pagan way of thinking. Whereas
it's kind of like a car. I think it all boils down to like cargo cult mentality, just more complicated forms of like cargo cultists. And modern spirituality is kind of like a cargo cult.
Meaning, I don't know what a cargo cult is.
Oh, you'll love this rabbit hole. But oh God! Cargo cults, like on Vanuatu, is a classic place. One of those Fijian or South Pacific islands, and there would be places where U.S. or European troops had landed, and then they got crates dropped, like from planes for the troops that were stationed there, and they had walkie-talkies, they had all this stuff. And so the tribal people would observe the soldiers talking on the walkie-talkies, and then some time passes, and then crates fall with food and clothes and provisions. And so they set up like landing strips, you know, they just flatten out some dirt. They wear what they can that looks like uniform. They take and make like walkie-talkies, you know, but just rocks or whatever it is, wood. And then they do the ritual to get the cargo.
Okay, that's fascinating.
Yes.
It's in complete alignment with how pagans would think. Yeah.
Yeah. You do the actions, and then you get the stuff. You get your cargo.
Yes.
You know?
Because to them, that's what works would be. You do the proper activity. And, you know, also pretty unfalsifiable, because you can just keep saying, you know, purity spiraling, as in you didn't make it well enough, you didn't flatten things.
The uniform wasn't proper.
Yeah. So, because what they would have seen is, okay, so this is some type of priestly garb, right? The uniform. I mean, they're all wearing it. They're obviously a type of, you know, shamanic figures. But then they have this scepter, or, you know, I don't know if I would call it a relic, but at least some type of artifice, you know, that they're using. Maybe they don't even know if it's communication or incantation, but, you know, something's going on. Then they have like a prepared site, which is again big in paganism. And then like things fall from the sky. I mean, that's, they might have figured out if it was by boat, but even then, like, saying to someone who's never heard of a walkie-talkie or you know, this type of communication, you know, just saying, oh no, I called for a ship that was, you know, 1,000 miles away. Yeah, sure you did, buddy. But you know, it can't go better than being airdropped. Because it's exactly falling from the sky. You may even hear, you know, like this roaring of the engines, and even seeing an airplane, you know. Try to convince a person that you made metal fly.
Yeah, exactly. And then you see the cargo, the people get their clothes, they get their food and everything. So yeah, this I've often related that to the spiritual milieu and stuff. It's, a lot of it's cargo cult.
Oh yeah, I need to use that. That's awesome.
There was a great story.
Was it cargo pants? You know, what is it, some type of derogatory term? But it makes sense now.
Well, there was a side note, was that the people of Vanuatu, at some point they thought that it wasn't really working because they didn't have the right leader. So they collectively saved up something like the equivalent of $20,000 and mailed it to the U.S. to ask, I think, Woodrow Wilson to come and be their president. And he sent back the money, you know, and
okay. That's, again, a very pagan thing. Like, you need this intermediary between the gods and the people, right?
Yeah.
Some type of god emperor figure. So you see, that was perfect. That again, you see these patterns everywhere, and you're not going to go to the Pacific Islanders and stuff like that and just say, well, they got it from the same place that they got it in the Middle East, and they got it in, you know, Ireland and everywhere else. You know, they just what's the term for it? It's not organic. Emergent phenomena, you know. Yeah, it's just emergent phenomena, or they will conclude that it started somewhere in Africa or wherever, you know, and then as people settled everywhere, it stayed. Like, that's, again, not how it works. There's a level of similarity you can justify with that, but how people built temples, how they perceived of all of these things, it's too ubiquitous. It's omnipresent, and people should be very wary of being so simple-minded about just saying, well, I guess things just stuck around to be this similar. Also, I find it hilarious to ask Woodrow Wilson. He probably thinks like bloody savages. He wasn't very progressive. Yeah.
Let me see if I find it. It was such a funny send money, U.S. president. His response was sweet. Let's see. Cargo cult clings to hope of U.S. millions. Oof. Cargo cult as theater. Oh, it was maybe I got my numbers wrong. Maybe it was Lyndon Johnson. Let me see.
Okay, that's. Oh yeah, I mean, they wouldn't have had walkie talkies back in Woodrow Wilson's time.
Here we go. It was one Melanesian cargo cult hit primetime news in 1964. The article was called "What Price LBJ?" The people in New Hanover in Papua New Guinea raised money to buy President Johnson, who would then rule the island, bringing with him, of course, cargoes of Hershey bars, cigarettes, and other luxuries. Okay, and it wasn't 20,000; it was $987 that they mailed to him.
987. Oh, God. I mean, there's almost a beauty to the simplicity of it.
Yeah, there is something sweet about it somehow.
Yeah. I mean, buying, worshipping a god for Hershey bars is a bit much, but...
Well, there was tobacco mentioned as well, and possibly...
Okay, alcohol, yeah. You know. But what can we know about that? I just
wait a minute. Which island is this? Yeah. Okay, so
Papua New Guinea, you said.
So cargo cults aside, I am fascinated by them. I occasionally remember them and look them up. But let's take a quick look at this. There's two things I wanted to cover. And this shouldn't take us too long. So we have share screen. Let's go to this. Now, I stopped paying attention to Logan because it was stirring up the passions in me too much. I was like showing up and just shitting on his Facebook post. So I stopped following him, hoping for our debate sooner or later. And I'm glad I did because I was just getting myself into madness trying to deal with his stuff in the comments. But I happened to see JB posted this the other day.
Just a moment.
Sure. We'll wait. Posh has it's a real life intervention here. Everything good?
Hey, I am. I've got about half an hour more.
Yeah, that's what I figured too. We don't even have to use all that time up. I have two things to touch on, and then I have to go do a cargo ritual later. So
those Hershey bars in Croatia, not as easily available.
Yeah, I want to get like Western Europe candy bars because they don't send, they send Croatia like the, there was a study that came out that they were comparing Snickers and Twix and tobacco and different things because it's supposed to be universal, same product in everywhere in EU. And they were sending Croatia like the throwaway.
Yeah, that's what we always joke around here. Like they don't even send us the proper like juice, you know, like Rauch or whatever. What do you think they send us for medicine?
Yeah, exactly.
But that's how we adapt to like a less prosperous market, because you can't expect like the earning potentials of both you know, Germany and then compare to the Balkans.
But to their credit, around this area, Bodonia and Slavonia, there is excellent meat and food available.
But that's local.
Yeah, exactly.
that can work. Okay, let's not keep.
So let's look at this thing. So this is Guy Logan. Hopefully, we will have a debate with me and you, Posh, and then Logan and this other guy, Will, who's some kind of anarchist animist. But I just want to look at what he posted here. It's funny. He's constantly borrowing from Bible. But let's just have a look at this. So it says, he says, religion is weaponized spirituality. False morality and total severance from the natural world. Apparently he's never read any Lives of Saints or Desert Fathers. But soul slavery, get out immediately. And then he shows this fishbowl. So religion is, so he's saying religion is the fishbowl and the spirituality is this, oh, we have access to the whole thing, the real ocean, you know, we're not just imprisoned in the little fishbowl. So I don't even know where to begin. See, I get terrorized by these kind of things because I can see a million different points to pull it apart. And then something inside me kind of like sighs and wants to give up.
You know? Yeah, that's basically my entire life. Constantly want to get into things, and then you have no idea. Probably like thousands of comments. I spent like 20 minutes typing. I just forget everything. You should all just die. But on the other hand, Jim Bob had a field day with this picture. The whole thing is, I still don't understand how they define religion, like organized religion, like as opposed to what? Just believing things in common, but not having an organization. Like people coalesce around things. I mean, if you're an anarchist, then you know I get it. I get
like where Logan has from. He has his channel. He has the Wizard Factory. A factory is something that produces. Things it's not, he didn't say like the wizard workshop or artisan, the wizard artisan workshop, where it's the wizard factory. So it's implying mass production.
Yeah.
It's implying mass production, an assembly line. It's a factory, something that produces. So it's producing wizards. And I don't think he thought it through to his credit,
but maybe we can easily read into things, but yeah, it's like he should have gone with artisan or something.
Something, yeah, workshop, but the
pre-level. Artisanal wizards, yeah.
Yes. So, false morality. Okay, let's try to, I don't even want to try to get in, I don't know. And then he has praise him, blessed, God is good. Christianity. So he's implicating Christianity in this. And people think that
he's not implying a different religion.
Right. But he does.
With slightly different robes, and long hairs, curly hairs on the side.
Right. Not that one. But it's crazy. So he's saying false morality. I've asked him a few times, where does morality come from? And he actually says from God or from Creator. He did say
that. That's saying nothing.
Yeah.
You know how I, on Jim Bob's stream, I said one of the weirdest things I find is like atheists who are anti-LGBT by means of saying it's unnatural. You don't believe there's anything supernatural. It's in accordance with natural law. Well, you just keep imposing things on it. Sex is for reproduction. Therefore, if you can't reproduce, then... and they never apply that consistently either, by the way. But nevertheless, you're sort of saying, it's natural that sex is for reproductive purposes. No, you are presupposing that. Right. From our worldview, it is. But we have a religious foundation for it. We don't say we are deriving it from nature because you can just do it for fun. You can do it. Therefore, you can't just impose on it a certain teleology and then, reverse engineer it back into it as if you've, just discovered it or, it's the chicken and egg thing. But if he says from God, where do the false moralities come from?
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm wondering. And where does his basis for making a moral claim? Because this whole thing is a moral claim that religion is bad and so whatever spirituality is good. And then that there is some, he's implying there is a true morality and that true morality comes from the natural world. I tried to pin him down on that before on some posts as well. I says, so you mean just might or force in the natural world? So the violence of the animals and he said, well, you know nothing about natural law. And I was like, well, man, just go to Alaska, go to the forest and taunt a grizzly bear and find out about natural law. I mean, I don't know what else it could be referring to.
Ironically, natural law is like a Catholic thing.
Yeah, that is strange. I don't think he's I don't think he's deriving it from Catholicism.
No, but like the way we tend to think about natural law is comes from Catholicism and then was bastardized further into just more bland, more factory-produced ways of thinking about it. You know, sort of saying you have a natural right to defend yourself.
Now, what? You know, in some ways, what he's this part of the reason this is so complex, what he's presenting and trying to unravel it, is that it could be seen as true if you're pointing at some type of experience with Catholicism or some type of experience with Protestantism, where the soul, let's say the soul could be enslaved with a sense of guilt and despair that I've seen in Protestants and in Catholics that I've met. I'm not saying all, I'm just saying that I can see in the West, in American Catholicism and American Protestantism, how that a person could have the experience that their soul is enslaved by that. And then the sad part about it is it sends them running toward atheism or towards relativism or towards this New Age spirituality as a sense of freedom. So then we have to qualify what is freedom. And I would say that freedom is being able to respond or to act in life in spite of our passions, in spite of our more base drives. So if you want to eat like a glutton, but you can actually stop yourself from doing so, I would say that is a form of soul freedom. That's it. There are one tiny example of it.
Oh, yeah. That's the biggest reason. One of the biggest things, you know, we see it also in the West with St. Augustine. But it's all throughout, you know, both the scriptures and the writings of the church fathers, that freedom comes from mostly from being free of the passions.
Yeah.
Like that's it's not having this external force, as in like a government oppressing you or threatening you, because you can be spiritually free. Even with that, you cannot be spiritually free under passions. It you know chains of gold and all that stuff. But again, they would have to appeal to some type of pragmatism. Like gluttony is wrong because you know you'll get fat, or you can develop some type of health problems because you overeat. But no, that you're not talking about morality. Then you're talking about practicality. You have to, because I can choose to value and prefer a shorter life with gluttony, with just drinking as much as I can, you know, partying and you know, debauchery, over like living 100 years, but you know, being a vegan or something. Mm-hmm. You know, you are sort of saying, implicit in that is you know, so how shall we say, that you should value longevity over over intensity, but you can't tell me why, you know.
And then again, if he is saying there's, if he's making any moral claim at all, this is a sell. His post is completely contradictory then, because he's saying freedom is being able to do whatever you want, not bound by the fishbowl, doing whatever you want, access to everything in the world at whatever quantities, whatever qualities, you know. And then at the same time that he's saying that there is some, you're supposed to want that rather than something else. Or if he made a claim, you should do what harms the least amount of people and makes you live the longest or something. If he makes that claim, yeah, now you're immediately back in a fishbowl again.
Yeah.
In his view.
Again, that's why Jim Bob had so much fun with this picture, because, you know, you can just add a shark and that's one way to do it. You can just rephrase things, right. You know, say, you know, instead of religion, put empathy, instead of spirituality, you put, you know, total freedom from from many considerations, because you just do it, you know, just impulsivity, let's say, instead of spirituality.
I want to have the fish with the little wooden walkie-talkie and the cargo falling into the bowl.
Yes. Into the bowl.
And the other fish is like, oh, Well, no Hershey's or tobacco for me, you know. That's
but
you
that's
don't
that's
do
great.
The ritual, no cargo for you. Yeah.
Yeah, man. I've seen a lot of again, right-wing commentariat is concerned with the type of sort of presupposing you secretly really want to do this, you know, like telling all the OnlyFans women, you know, you actually want to have a child. And she's like, no, I'm earning like 100K for, you know, showing my bum. Pretty good deal. Sounds like a pretty good deal to me. No, but what you really want. Well, you're sort of ignoring the whole thing that we are changed from our perspective, Orthodox perspective. We are changed by how we live. If we live a godly life, we become more like him. If we live a demonic life, we are going to become more like them. Yeah. And that's that. You change yourself to just hope that at a certain point, you know, the biological clock kicks in. You know, you again, people are very, very resistant to this type of common sense thinking. All of us are. You know, you're sort of saying, oh, once you hit 31, oh boy, the egg carton's going empty. Then you will realize, like, okay, you're not showing anything other than, like, in 10 years you'll feel sorry that you didn't do what I said. But again, it's not a guarantee. Mm-hmm. It's a bet. And the problem is that they think, oh yeah, but isn't it true? Sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. A lot of them go into their grave thinking that this is the best thing ever. The fact that you found some, and there was a very viral video of this old feminist, you know, saying, oh, I regret everything I've done because now I'm all alone. And, you know, and she's like in her 70s, 80s, something like that. It's like, well, we told you. Okay. There are women who did get married and everything and ended up alone. You cannot guarantee.
Yeah, there's widows and things.
Yeah, yeah. And I'm saying you can't just promise people stuff. There is no promise of it. You need to say why, even if you end up in a very unenviable place, you should go for it, right? You should just, you know, submit to worshiping the God Emperor of Rome, you know, because you'll have, you know, you won't be executed, and then you can have more time to worship God and convert people. You know, that's the type of thinking we fall into, because in a way it does make sense, right? Okay, I won't mean anything by burning this incense for the emperor, but then I'll use my time, you know, to convert more people. And by the way, every time we do these things, we end up not doing the difficult part. So, you know, it's sort of like, oh God, if you help me with this, I will do X, and then God helps you, and then you don't do X.
Yeah.
Or you sort of start it off, and then I'll take a break from it for a week, and then you never get back into it. But yeah. At the same time, the main point I was making is that no one would ever accept this type of thinking from how leftists do it. Oh, you're against the LGBT thing because you're secretly gay, right? Oh. And you, or the even more prevalent one is, you know, you're secretly racist. You're even subconsciously racist. You're subconsciously this or that. There is no way to fend off the accusation, because if you defend yourself, they'll say it's a proof that thou protesteth too much, methinks, you know, and all of that stuff. And if you accept it, then you have accepted it. So there's no way to win. This is the type of argumentation he is using. It's the fact that you might agree with, for example, with marriage or whatever, how you might, if it is pushing the thing, the behavior in the direction you want, that doesn't mean it's a good methodology to go about implementing, because the problem with the methodology is that it's unreliable, and like I said, a lot of problems stem from the fact that people would just reassert their position in the past. You know, do I really need to tell you why homosexuality is wrong and should be banned? Right. It works until people say, yeah, okay, go ahead, explain it to me. And then if you've got nothing, well, there you go. And now people are going to turn it around on you and say, well, you have no objections. Your system cannot account for your positions. Mm-hmm. And it will collapse very quickly. That's how we went. Like in the United States, you went from like every possible politician was against same-sex marriage. In 10 years, you know, we were transing kids. Because the system was built on this type of thinking. But this type of thinking coming from someone like Logan, they don't have to do anything. They just have like a group online. They don't have to govern a society. Most of their interactions is like with people they talk to, like you and I talk, or talk with people like Organizer and Dr. Crispy Rothschild. You know, we don't govern their lives. At least I don't. Maybe you do. I'm not privy to that information.
Thank God, but, no.
Yeah, thank God for them. You know,
indeed.
I just established a dictatorship. But, you know, if we were in positions of power and we had to make decisions that had palpable consequences, yeah. We can't have this type of wishy-washy, you know, rubbish. Because it would end up causing consequences, and that's when the dialectic hits in, yeah. Right? You get the thesis, antithesis, synthesis. They never get to the antithesis part because it's never implemented. So you end up just arguing, you end up debating. You do not have, because the antithesis arises from the problems of implementing the thesis. So while it stays in the abstract and in the realm of sloganeering, you're very safe from the rise of the antithesis.
When you have, you have to be asking, what am I missing? What might I not understand? What could be, and generally ask some, the antithesis has to come from outside, or at least approximating outside.
Yeah.
For there to even be a possible synthesis. It's not exactly a simple solo endeavor.
Yeah. And that's the biggest problem here. That these people just don't, they never, you know, the old saying in politics, nothing easier than being the opposition. Because you just sit there and complain.
Of course, and you know what to complain about, right? Yeah, you just look at what's
happening. Yeah. So whatever is implemented is going to have problems. If you lower taxes, they're going to be problems. If you raise taxes, they're going to be problems. So where you just sit and constantly harp on about the problems, and this is how simplistic thinking arises. They have no position, but they can look at Christianity, and especially because they won't care about, you know, if this is Orthodoxy, if this is Catholicism, if this is Protestantism. To them, it's like this blob of Christianity. And so, well, you had the Puritans who did X, and then you had the Spanish Inquisition, and then you've got Vladimir Putin, who's the the patriarch of Russia, stuff like that. You know, they'll just sit there and complain because their system will never be implemented. Now, I'm constantly reminded of one of my favorite things in the world was seeing like a clip from a Vorsch debate, you know, who Vorsch is, the git. He said he's some type of anarcho-syndicalist, I believe. And the person who was debating him was some type of philosophy PhD. And he says, okay, but what would you do if you establish your anarcho-syndicalist commune or whatever, and outside forces want to attack you? And he says, well, I don't believe it can be implemented. Again, so you believe in a system that can't work. Great job. but it's a great way out, because you don't have any power outside of, you know, governing yourself. And he does a rather poor job of that as well. I don't know if you saw it. he accidentally showed parts of his porn folder. So
who did this?
Vorsch.
Oh, he did. I heard something
like last week or something, and
something. I didn't know what they was referencing. Yeah,
I could just hear Andrew laughing in my head.
Oh man.
Oh yeah.
So I wanted to contrast
stuff.
Oh god.
I'm not joking.
We're hitting all the buttons here for the YouTube algorithm. No, I think we're safe.
We're still too small for serious, unless we make it too easy for the algorithm.
I wanted to contrast this point of view on religion that Logan supports with just this quick story. In a future stream, Posh, we'll get into one. I think it would be really interesting to do an cavalier introduction to Orthodoxy, kind of from the... this area to the West could be interesting, and highlight with just you and I can each pick 10 short stories from Lives of Saints and just go over them and share about them, you know. So in the future we can do one like that. It'll take some more preparation, but I think it could be really interesting for people. One I wanted to share, and he's not a saint as far as I know, they call him Elder Pavel, but I wanted to show this. We'll just show his picture, and I'll oops, not just me. There we go. We don't need the custom hand-painted icons order form, although that's nice too. This picture is so interesting. I'll see what I can do to just tell the briefest version of this story, and people can read it. I'll put the link to the article in the description. So it's Elder Pavel, and you can see from his eyes, he was in Russia during he was blinded from being tortured for not giving up Christ during communist Russia. So at some point, I forget why, but he gets slowly everything taken away from me as like one icon left. And then eventually they send him to the prison camp, I believe in Siberia. It's all snowy. And he was always taking care of the other prisoners. And one day the prisoners didn't look out for him. He didn't get any bread. And so he just walks off into the woods, and this is all snowy, crazy Siberian winter. And suddenly he sees an open patch with grass and edible mushrooms just sitting right there, right in front of him. And he's like, oh, thank you, Lord. Collects the mushrooms, makes a little fire, eats, and is full. At another point, they caught him praying. And so then they chain him up to a tree and take off his boots, and his boots are in the snow. And he just... sat there or hung there and watched. He said his feet got super hot and all the snow beneath him melted. And from that day on, for the rest of his life, he said he could walk barefoot in the snow and ice and his feet would just be warm, but that he wouldn't do it in public because he didn't want anyone else to feel bad or embarrassed. But people had seen this occur, and he got beaten and tortured so badly he could barely see. And then he wrote back to his family when he was in the prison camp. He said, well, people talk about some extreme circumstances, but I'm not in extreme circumstances. God's looking out for me here. And he wasn't just saying it to make his family feel better. He was being honest. It was consistent letters over time with him just in wonder at what God was doing for him through this prison experience. And then many years later, they said, how did you become so holy, elder or father? All thanks to the prison, he said.
Glory to God. But this is a great place to wrap it up. The biggest reason, as I said, we get mentions of not just bad individuals, but also nations and groups and stuff in the Bible, isn't to point fingers and say, oh, the Jews are like this, and the Romans are like that, the Greeks are like this, and then, you know, point to Samson or Jephthah or whoever had problems, King David or Solomon. In fact, they're King David is, I believe, the most complete singular, you know, figure that we meet very young and stay with until the end. Mm-hmm. So it's a great story to follow how things play out. You know, it's not like finding someone and they end up being horrible, or they end up being very holy, because there's a whole progression to it. And we are shown this so that we are reminded of our own shortcomings. And one of the biggest examples is the Israel in the desert, right? Because God provided, you know, saying something like, oh, he found, you know, edible mushrooms or something, you know, that's, you know, we almost become Protestant-y. Like, oh yeah, it happened in the Bible, but it's not going to happen here, right? That was back then. No, God provided, but what he asked for was faithfulness to his promise. Mm-hmm. Right? It was always a condition, by the way, no blood stuff. I mean, like, inheritance and by the in those means. It was always, if you follow my commandments, you will be my people. No. But part of that is trusting God, and he was consistent on his end. But even after being consistent for a while, people would still, you know, they would take a bit more manna than they were told to take, and you know, it would rot. And they said those who took less always had enough, right? Mm-hmm. When you start reading the Old Testament, like go into the details, it starts sounding very much like we read in the lives of the saints. Yeah. You know, there's none of this prosperity gospel and stuff. God wasn't even too happy about, you know, the cities, because they can turn rough very quickly. That's why you had the Feast of the Tabernacles. You know, you are going to go back into the desert, not because you deserve it or you need to be punished, but not to forget where you were and where you were brought out of. So, and then when they asked for meat, God even gave that. Again, God was humble even in the Old Testament. No Marcionism or semi-Marcionism on this channel. So what we're told, like with this elder and like with many, many stories, and unfortunately, you know, the only thing we can gain from things like communism and stuff is we get a lot of martyrs. With stories like this, we are reminded that you can be left in the lap of luxury and then still be consumed. This is the story of the rich man and Lazarus. Mm-hmm. This is all throughout the Old Testament, you know, with King David, when he is told the story of a rich man who took, who had a feast and took the one goat that his neighbor had, who was very poor, to slaughter it for the feast. Mm-hmm. And he was absolutely livid and wanted that rich man killed. And then Nathan, the advisor, you know, tells him, well, that's you making. And that's when he breaks down. That's when he starts his, you know, what's it called? It's not a repentance arc, but a repentance arc. So as we read these stories, we shouldn't think of them as something new. We should think of them as something that has been maintained throughout the millennia by the people of God, right? And to an extent, that was the pre-incarnation Israel. Now it's the new Israel. which again doesn't mean we are the only good ones, everyone else sucks. Exactly, Evanizer, you know, nothing new under the sun.
I mean, the main point for showing this, and hopefully people go read the whole article, it's such a beautiful thing. It was also to show that the other details of it, he was well-versed in edible wild plants, medicinal mm-hmm. plants. He was healing prisoners with just going out and finding herbs and things, even in the winter. He was completely connected to nature. So we juxtapose this guy, just one example of thousands we can find, Elder Pavel, with this crap. And it's like, this, and I'm not trying to attack Logan personally. I'm just saying total severance from the natural world. This is 100% connection with the natural world, where the natural world starts bending to God's will around this guy. Well, he's living in faithfulness according to ancient tradition, where you can point to what is morality and what is not. Everything's grounded. Everything makes sense to this guy. He's remained simple.
And he
became holy in his simple faith and dedication to this ancient tradition.
No Christianity is simple, but not easy.
no one said it's easy.
Yeah, so I think the problem is that, you know, how people think, oh, you weren't allowed to use medicinal herbs and stuff like that. No, like you had no shortage of them being used in monasteries. The problem is that, you know, people who were being, you know, persecuted for using, you know, herbalists and stuff, was that they tended to be practicing more of the thing of, oh, you take a chicken leg and, you know, you hang it upside down in above the cauldron and then you add this and that. It wasn't a medicine for them. It was a pagan ritual, and it tended to be used for very nefarious things. You know, Rachel documents this in her work, that a lot of it was, you know, to induce abortions. So, like, that's when people got upset. And this is a great place to mention it, I think, because they think of, like, Puritans, because Puritans just killed everyone and everything that moved. But them seeing Christianity as just whatever branch, you know, would claim itself as Christianity, they are in the fold. And therefore, they won't see us as Orthodox as any different. Maybe we have, like, the guys in funny hats. But again, well, Puritans have pretty funny hats. but we have the fancy funny hats. So they won't actually engage with our theology, because they'll just lump it in as just this madness of Puritanism. And also that's largely because Puritanism was massive. Its influence was massive in the general culture of the United States. So they're going to always have that feeling, that resonance with how to perceive Christianity is going to be stemming from that as well. And then not to mention how much has been exaggerated about the Inquisition. If you look at, I think in the entire history of the Inquisition, they've killed fewer people than Puritans did only in Scotland. It's ridiculous. Like, most of these people, like I keep saying, the author of the Malleus Maleficarum, like the Hammer of the Witches, like he was ridiculed for his works, like saying demons elope with women and they produce these like demon babies, and he went to Innsbruck and they were like, are you joking? Turns out the man also was not particularly pleased that a certain woman said no to him. So he's like a Nietzsche. Oh, man. Very angry man. But, yeah, you know, they see Christianity as just this nonsense, as just barbarism. Meanwhile, they promote the thing that would cause the barbarism, because they hate the idea of order. They hate the idea that, again, you have to do something about stuff. You know, that's not a controversial statement, but that's going to come with problems. So if you're going to keep saying, oh, yeah, but if you don't have the state, you know who killed the most people in the 20th century? The government. Okay, so you think then you remove the government and then things work fine, right? Well, no. Okay, have you tried that anywhere? Well, no, we have. Oh, there's like a village in Italy. There's a village in Italy that can do it. I'm certain we can apply it to a country of 340 million people. Yeah. That's how things scale up. Same with like the people who are like the homesteading movement. Right. Okay, so you don't drive a car, you don't use, you know, like hoes and spades and you know, rakes and stuff that you buy at Home Depot or somewhere. Yeah, you know, those are mass produced in factories. And I keep saying they weren't, you know, forged by the local blacksmith who got it. Yeah. Who would again also have to get it from some type of, you know, industrial process, just that.
Well, he had to be connected primitive to the mines at least. Yeah. The coal plus metal, iron mines, yeah, and transportation of the metal.
But they ignore all that. They just focus on the consumer side. Yeah. Oh, well, I grow. Look at this tomato.
that's what I'm getting at. Everything became a spectacle, and I think that people are yearning for something real, something outside of the spectacle. But the spectacle is so ubiquitous and so absorbing. So all-encompassing that people have been taught to accept an idea of something more than even finding the thing itself. And because it's so ubiquitous, they don't even know that that's not the real. That's not the grounded actual. That's not grounded actuality. It's the snow globe. It's taking place completely within an intellectual space.
Yes, so to you, organizer, who said it's good to have local stuff, but it's not the end goal. Exactly, as I always say when I mention the homesteading thing, I feel like I'm saying that I'm not racist, but you know, I support homesteading. I just hate this quasi-eschatological you know, feel that it has to it with certain people, whereas you need industry. Everyone always needed industry. If you don't plan to go back to, you know, wooden tools, you know, good luck with that. So yes, things should be local to the extent that they can. And because I'm one of the apparently few people who, when I was a socialist when I was, you know, between 12 or 13 up until I was 15. You know, when I lost the ability to believe that it could work, that was a shock to me. You know, I didn't have like this moment of, well, I guess I grew up. You know, I was just, I can't believe I actually believed this thing. So I went to read more and the arguments, like you can't have everything locally because you're not going to get things locally that don't exist in the locality. You know, you're going to only have access to certain resources from certain geographies. You know,
you see what I mean? How we are all cargo cultists on some level.
Yeah,
the tools just come. They come in a crate from the sky.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. And instead of the walkie-talkies, you use the Amazon.
Yeah, use an app website on your phone. The cargo.
Yeah.
It works every
time. Yeah, and because people don't devote any time thinking to this, and this is how you get the vegans, this is how you get the old types of people who just want to keep adding restrictions on agricultural production, you know, because they just think food is like there, you know, you like make it, and that it's not a massive process, that it's not just so incredibly fragile. Like, again, it's very easy to complain about pesticides. Okay, do you think everyone can you know, have like a small garden to produce for themselves? Well, okay, how many would you need just to settle like one block of flats? you flatten it out, pun not intended, you flatten it out into like a couple of home, like do the homesteads for every flat.
Yeah,
it's going to become very uninhabitable very quickly. Not in the United States, maybe, because it's so massive and so sparsely populated. Europe would just be nothing but homesteads. who wouldn't work? Which wouldn't work, I mean.
Well, you'd have to be working on it all. You'd have to work on it pretty consistently to completely feed your family and some neighbors, you know.
Yeah. And the thing is, you then realize when I was a child, we had like this a garden in my father's home village. But it was like one of those things that we can, but we don't have to. And I remember like the types of bugs, and my grandfather was explaining it to me, like, oh, these ones attack potatoes, these ones go for this, the other one goes for that. And the problem then is that, okay, you're going to have to do something about that, because the good food especially is very, very difficult to maintain over time. Mm-hmm. Because without the preservatives, their point is to preserve, you're going to have very perishable food, you know.
Yeah. The route there is fermentation. That's one classic
solution. Yes, right. And in this area, we do a lot of fermented, you know, cabbage, you know, sauerkraut and stuff like that, very rich in vitamins and all that.
Delicious, but, too. Yeah.
especially in the winter months. But the thing also is, it's fermentation, it can be salted, but I mean like the production phase. And then you have to preserve it in some way. And without refrigeration, that's nigh impossible. With so much of our work being so segmented to the point that we don't ever pay attention to anything else. Like, again, you can make fun of the middle class people for thinking food materializes on, you know, rafts in Whole Foods, but then you think again, you know, gardening tools materialize in Home Depot. So that's not much better. The Home Depot cult.
Yeah. I know. Yeah. I'd like to make, maybe I'll make a fun video about cargo cultists compared to modern spirituality.
You definitely should, because
this could be very interesting. Yeah.
Since you have some knowledge of it already, I have none. I've just found out.
Isn't it a refreshing thing?
Oh, yeah.
To learn about it? It's like it makes sense of so many other things to know.
Yeah, and it's not a depressing thing, you know. As we said, there's like a wholesomeness to it, like a naivete. Yeah. But so it wouldn't be like, oh, look at this cult. They all massacred and made babies and whatever. So it's a refreshing
thing. This is the last thing I'll say about it. I know you got to go. Someone explained to me this about God at one point. Like, imagine if you're just sitting on the street, which almost no one ever, sitting at the park, and you see an ant or a slug or something crawling across the trail, or a snail, whatever. And it's almost all the way across, or a yej, a hedgehog. Let's try to say something cute so people don't have any excuse. The hedgehog, and then you see, okay, there's bikes coming and people coming, and the hedgehog's kind of scared, but it made its way all the way across the trail. You're probably going to pick it up and just set it in the grass, you know? And he was saying, like, if God was watching us, you know, if I had cargo, and I was in charge of a lot of cargo, and I had surplus, and then I noticed there were cargo cults, I might drop some cargo there when they're doing their thing, you know? I'd feel kind of like, you know, so I want to leave it open that
you're joining idolatry on the side of the idol.
If they had God, you know, if they were asking God directly or Christ for the cargo, and I was God, I might allow for that miracle. You know, drop the cargo.
And there's like a cross on it.
With the little thing at the bottom. Yeah, if they were faithful cargo cultists, they believe in one God. Okay. I would want to drop them the cargo, but the, sometimes I feel like that with prayer and stuff like that. Like, okay, I'm kind of a miserable wretch on some levels, not really living up to even the goals I set for myself all the time, but sometimes, but then there's occasions I do receive grace, you know, inexplicable.
Yeah, it really gives you the energy to keep pushing forward. So, and again, it's not like God is angry, so he does X, he's happy, so he does Y.
So I do receive bits of cargo, you know, if we call.
We're overextending the cargo.
No, I know. It's fun.
Anyway, it's a bit... But definitely you should do something on the topic.
Yeah, it could be good. Anyway, great to see you, Posh. It's been a while, but really happy to connect and talk. And yeah, next time we'll do something slightly more formal with some saints and some...
Yeah, this was improvised. I literally texted you last night.
Yeah.
Today works for me very well. So yeah, we definitely need to be more structured.
Well, at the next one, it'll be fun with some saints, stories of saints, and we can each bring a little bit to it. And sounds good. All right, Posh, have fun out there, and we'll talk to you again soon. God bless.
Okay, I'll be live tomorrow, just to mention to people who are here on my channel about, I'll probably call it linguistic chicanery or something like that, talking about like how words get misused all the time. That's the only plug I have. Other than that, thank you for having me.
Of course.
For the chat. And thank you all for in the chat for being here.
Yeah, thanks everybody. We didn't engage the chat super much this time, but I was noticing it and I enjoyed everybody here. And yeah, I put the link to Posh's channel in the description. So anyone who's watching who's unfamiliar, go check him out. It's pretty fun stuff. You can learn something. And I think that's all for now.
And watch me play ridiculous instruments.
I love that part of it. Yeah. We need more of that. I think that's,
I'm getting into it.
Excellent.
Okay. Thank you. And God bless.
Thank you as well. God bless. Ciao.
Ciao.